Aunque la conferencia va a ser en inglés, yo voy a presentar primero en español a Jörg Kuhn y luego proceder en inglés. Él entiende bien español, con lo cual no hay problema. Jörg Kuhn es arquitecto desde hace 35 años. Estudió en la Universidad de Darmstadt, la ciudad que nos une. Como sabéis, Marta y yo estudiamos ahí, en la Universidad de Darmstadt. Y Adrián también estudió por allí. Y está ahora mismo dando clases en la Universidad de Cottbus. Allí ha sido el responsable del departamento de proyectos. Fue el responsable de la extensión del campus, fue el responsable de obras durante un tiempo. En su mano estuvo el diseñar cómo iba a ser la nueva biblioteca o algunas de las ampliaciones que sufrió la universidad. Y él fue el encargado de actuar como propiedad con los arquitectos Herzog y de Meuron, que fueron los que hicieron ese proyecto, que probablemente todos habréis visto en páginas web. Y en su quehacer profesional, una de las cosas que también le ha tenido entretenido es la construcción de cárceles, con las que él se ha planteado cómo se puede transformar la sociedad con este tipo de edificio, que no es un edificio convencional, ¿no? Nosotros le hemos invitado porque el año que viene probablemente tendremos el workshop con él, por lo menos en su universidad, la Universidad de Cottbus, en Alemania, y este año vamos a tener el intercambio de profesores también con ellos, y por eso queríamos que le conocierais y que nos pudiera compartir estas sensaciones sobre arquitectura.
And yet, auf Englisch. Lassen wir so.
Ja, lass es so. Alles so. Gut, ja. Yeah.
Bueno, queda introducido, lo ha entendido todo. Y a partir de ahora subir la charla. Muchísimas gracias por estar con nosotros.
Yeah. Thank you very much, Felipe. I'm very glad to be here today. Thank you very much for the invitation. And sorry, I cannot do the lecture in your language, but I hope everybody understands me. I try to speak slow. And if there should be an urgent question in between, don't hesitate to raise your hand, because that doesn't disturb me at all. I want to speak about, or the title of my lecture will be Comments on Architecture, Projects and Attitudes. Projects, of course, I will show some of my projects, but in a sense not showing projects, but I want to describe in that short time the attitudes, the responsibility of an architect nowadays in society, with the project I made, so the focus will be on that. I will have three parts. In the beginning, briefly, I'd like to introduce my university, which is the Brandenburg University of Technology. In the second part, we have those projects and attitudes. And in the third part, which is very important for me, I would like to have some time for discussion, give possibility to you to ask questions and discuss. I mean, that's a major thing in architecture is communication. So let me start on a brief flash back to the German history, because that is very much linked to the history of my university. This is Germany before 89. You see here this red line is the so-called Iron Curtain, not only separating the Federal Republic of Germany, which is blue, to the Democratic Republic of Germany, which is red. The former capital was Bonn, a little village on the River Rhine, and the capital of East Germany was East Berlin. The West Berlin part, this little blue dot, belonged to us. This is Germany today. The former Iron Curtain was this, and very far in the east is a town which is not big, about 100,000 inhabitants, Cottbus. That's where my university is. And that's the only university of technology in the country, in the county of Brandenburg, with his capital in Potsdam. A little flashback also to the history of Philippe and Martha. This is Darmstadt, also not such a big town where we studied. So in thinking and in mentality, I think you cannot deny when you studied somewhere that you are influenced by this. This is the campus of our university. It was Academy for Civil Engineers before reunification in 89. It would lead too far to explain everything, but we have a very long axis here, which is the Konrad-Wachsmann-Allee. The streets are still East German. This is the Karl-Marx-Straße, and here Yuri Gagarin-Straße. And remind these two H-shaped buildings. This is the Faculty of Architecture, Civil Engineering, and Urban Planning. So we have not only architects, but urban planners and civil engineers under the roof of one faculty, which is very logical and which is a new model. And here on the other side of the Karl-Marx-Straße, you see the icon of our university, which is that building of Herzog de Meuron. Here are these buildings of our faculty. The university has four faculties. First is the basic faculty for each university of technology, mathematics, natural science, computer science. Faculty three is mechanical engineering, electrical engineering, and economical engineering. Faculty four was at the time when we have founded, right after reunification in 91, Faculty of Environmental Sciences and Process Engineering, the first faculty, complete faculty in Europe, dealing with environmental facts. And this faculty two, which are we with all these study courses, structured engineering, civil engineering, urban planning, building conservation, very important. And this also is unique. I also teach in World Heritage Studies. We do together with UNESCO in Paris. My chair at the university, I'm professor for architectural design, building typology, and spatial organization. Some numbers, our university in comparison to other universities in Germany is quite small. We have currently around 8,000 students. What is very surprising is the ratio between female and male students. We have 3,300 female students and 4,300 male students, which is unusual for a university of technology. And another very unusual number is the ratio between Germans and foreigners. We have 1,600 foreign students, which is up to 20%. And they come from 100 countries in the world. Believe it or not, but it's like this. And for a university of technology, very unusual. Let's come to the numbers of our faculty. Or in the study course of architecture, currently we have 720 students. And this number also is very unusual. We have 400 female students, much more female students than male students. And we have our ratio of foreign students is 30%. We are very proud of this number. In average in German university, we have between 10-15%, something like this. And we still enforce to have more foreign students. I will come back to that later because I think that is a major element in modern teaching. Back to those H-shaped buildings, just an episode. This is our faculty along this Yuri Gagarin Street. These were old DDR buildings, which you see in the back. And we added these glass heads, four of them, to those buildings. And these are all ateliers. And these ateliers are open 365 days a year, 24 hours. So whenever you have an idea as an architectural student, you can go to those things. And the clue of this story is that these buildings were built by students. There was a supervision in the background from us professors, but the students from the first design till the calculation in the end was done by our students some 10, 15 years ago. This is the icon of our university, the EKMZ, they call it the library. You have here the ground floor plan, a natural shaped ground floor. It would lead too far to explain everything, but it's the most modern, in the best sense of the word, library in Europe. It has some spectacular specifications. For example, on all seven floors it's open, which is very unusual for a library. And it has become, like I said, the icon of the university. Even the design of our symbol comes from that ground floor plan. This is the facade, a double facade with glass, and there are, if you look from far, there are printed letters on that facade, and that is the inner staircase. Our campus, you see here the axis, this is the forum with the Audimax, the Mensa, lots of open spaces, here again the Audimax. We have a number of beautiful new buildings, which of course if you in 91 built a new university, we spent in those years until the year of 2000, where the process was ended, we spent about 300 million euros in creating that university and those buildings. This is a laboratory for finding out new materials. It was done by an assistant professor of our university. We put much emphasis on international students and on international courses. So some years ago, I gave a lecture or organized a lecture series, Get in Touch with the Dutch, where we invited a number of world-known Dutch architects to our university, like Joe Koonen, like Architectenzy, Benjamin Kraul, MV, RDV, where you have buildings here in Madrid, and Wiel Aretz and others. And surprisingly, they came all, and this was organized and supported by the embassy of the Kingdom of the Netherlands, and as I see, you have something similar, and you could do it as well. They support this lecture series with money. They pay the flights and everything, which is a good thing to do. And this is what it's all about. Also, my lecture today, the two universities, and this might be or should be the link in future, the Erasmus Plus program, which supports and this teaching staff mobility is only the start. I'm aiming very directly and on short terms together with Felipe and Marta that we in short term have a lively student exchange. This is our ateliers, and you see we work day and night. It's a good atmosphere, and I think it will be a benefit for both institutions. Okay. That was part one. Part two. I would like to start with a statement. Walter Gropius, I think it's known as name, was the founding director of the Bauhaus. And in 1920, imagine almost 100 years ago, he wrote this sentence: "The chronic disease of our contemporary cities and settlements is the sad result of our failure to arise basic human needs beyond economical and industrial requirements." And if you look at that closely, nothing has changed so much, because architecture is a very complex thing. But I have the feeling, and I share this with many other architects, that other things have come to priority nowadays while making architecture, and forgetting the basic things. That architects are not only builders of houses, but we are creators of space. And we very often deny this, and we create this space not for good proportions, for nice facades or something like this, but for basic human needs. And this is what I want to tell about today. Let me start with a very personal aspect. No future without heritage. This was my first lecture when I came to university in 92 to Cottbus, because I so much convinced that especially architects, let me put it this way, you do what you are. You cannot find things completely new. Things are inside you, the way you grow up, the way the influences, many terms, influences you have, your education later, but that is what your personality makes. And from this origin, you make architecture. My personal background, I do not come from a dynasty of architects or famous engineers. Nobody ever in my family has been in touch with architecture. But my grandfather, he was a bricklayer, and they built in brick material Gothic churches in the outgoing 19th century. And he was the boss of this group, and as a child he always told me about this, and it interested me a lot. He was also very much politically active in workers' union. And I think my decision, which I took before leaving school to be an architect, comes from that period. But then I decided not to work on bricks, but Mies van der Rohe, famous German architect, said an architect is a bricklayer who learned Latin. So I decided to learn Latin at university to become an architect. Two more architects which very much influenced me, and only by coincidence they were my teachers at university. Philippe and Martha know them because they were professors in Darmstadt. This was is Helmut Striffler. This is a little chapel, a tiny little building, but it's for me the best building I've ever seen. It's not a building, it's a sculpture. It's a little chapel on the ground of the concentration camp of Dachau. As you know, we have dozens of concentration camps. Has to do with our terrible history, where millions of people, of Jews, were killed. And it took a long time to have this political memory and to give it a form. And this is very, very serious and a very difficult topic. I don't want to go into details, but this is a speaking architecture. You don't have to explain anything to people of all cultures. No explanation, they come there and they are touched, because they immediately know what is meant to build a building which resembles shame and sorrow, but at the same time hope. It's a very simple, long concrete, very rough concrete wall, which you see here, and it's a stair going down, and the ground goes as a rooftop, but which ends shortly before this wall, and you are guided by the light and you come into a courtyard. Here is a chapel, and after you leave the chapel, the wall goes up and you go into the light. I've never seen a building like this, so it's my personal, my second, and it's at the same time standing for the post-war German architecture, is Günter Behnisch. Maybe the name doesn't tell you much, but he was the creator in 72 of the Olympic Park in Munich, which is a big tent, transparent tent. And he later on built the German Bundestag, the parliament in Bonn, which you see here. And his ideology was to transport democracy in the language of building. And he says democracy is transparency, and you have to feel that and to show it. And if you go back in that time, this construction was very unusual, at least in this size. So it's a pioneer work. And he influenced me very much to simplify things and to consider architecture as being something being open and transparent, whereas the chapel is something which is down to earth, which is very archaic. Yeah. So then a big influence came. I'm married to a Dutch woman, but not only because that, because I always admired this little country for its spectacular architecture. We lived together in Amsterdam for 2 years, which you can see here, and this is a motif of these famous Van Gogh buildings. But what is interesting much more, how this open and very pluralistic society handles old and new. This is the world famous Stedelijk Museum in Amsterdam, and there is an extension, it's quite new, which you on first sight would say that doesn't match at all. But you know, those the Holland architects like confrontations, they like experiments, and not always this fits. But this is something in society what counts. This is one of our professors that was in Cottbus, Bentham and Crowell, and they call it the Bathtube. Yeah? And spatially, it works perfectly. And then this is in the harbor, a growing city, and you think these are houses. These are floating homes. These are houses up to 4 floors on boats. So I think the Dutch are preparing for the rise of the sea level in terms of the climate change. But this is experimental building. I was very much busy with Hermann Herzberger, a structuralist. I started as an assistant professor to write my PhD thesis, but then had to stop because I was building. I knew Aldo van Eyck, the first and only architect who had an exhibition in the famous Documenta. And my all-time favorite is Rietveld, a Dutch architect in the 20s, which never studied architecture, and he is world famous. This should not be an example for your students not to study architecture. But this tells the story that there are many different ways to come to this. And he was a cabinet maker. Look at, Look at his hands. I mean, you can hardly imagine that this man who was a worker, you know, could do such fine things and draw plans. But he, and this is very, I forgot this, and I come back to this Bauhaus, the style movement from 17 when there was the October Revolution in Russia. In architecture, they had something similar. This is an exhibition some 10 years ago, Visions of Utopia. And this is lacking today. We, as architects, criticize, and I do this very hard. We have no visions for the future. I mean, the world has been so complex in the last years with all those political conflicts and that. And we, as architects, who over all periods gave guidelines, this generation, for example, and we have no answers. We just draw beautiful buildings which seem to be sensational, but we are spatially not interesting. And this is what we could discuss also later. So this is my absolute fantastic building. This is the Rietveld Schröder House. You might all know it's a World Heritage Site. As my wife comes from Utrecht all the time, I'm there, I go there. I've been there 60, 70, 80 times. And each time I come there, I go there. And I stand there and admire this building and think, what is it possible 100 years ago? This could have been built yesterday, and we would still say as architects, it's genius, it's perfect. And it's not the form of the house. Look at this little sketch. It's the spatial thinking. This is the upper floor here. And as the family had 3 children, the architect at that time with low technical tools created a space that during the day could be opened. You put all the walls away, and you had an open space, and in the night, you put the walls back to their position, and the children had 3 sleeping rooms in 1924. And look at our housing projects today. Terrible, isn't it? Okay. So through Rietveld and his famous red and blue chair from 17, this is Piet Mondrian, late drawing in his 1 year before he died in New York, called Broadway Boogie Woogie. By this I came to the idea to get very much interested in furniture. And I started while being a student to design furniture, which I do till today. And the house of Rietveld, I don't want to comment, but the knots here, the way it is constructed, you will find in this Rietveld-Schröder house. So Rietveld said, furniture is small architecture, and before you build big buildings, try the details on small furniture. So if you look in history, many architects parallel to their building are architects. So my architectural life began as a student with these little sketches. I worked to earn money for my living for a newspaper research institute when computers were introduced. And very simple, rectangular table. And they said, okay, why is the table rectangular when the movement of the arms of people is not rectangular, it's round? So the basic idea is something like this. This is a perfect table. And I took up this idea and designed for a company in Frankfurt. These are dealer tables for banks with computers, etc. And I said, okay, why not make it like this? So very quickly you put two together and all of a sudden you have a group like this, which besides the fact that they are very economical, you have between the dealers, you have a perfect combination, which you never have when the system is linear. So we put this, I put this together, and for this company I took part in a competition in Tokyo. That was an American bank from head office in Los Angeles. And for their Tokyo branch, in a very small and long room, they wanted to put in, as the prices in Tokyo are immense, as much as dealers as they could. So I won the first prize in this competition and went to Tokyo for 3 weeks to build up this room with lots of specifications. For example, the light, you will not see any lamp because this light from the ceiling puts reflections on your screens. So I said, simple idea, put the light from down to the ceiling and reflect it back, no reflections. This system has the advantage that you put up to 30% more of these dealers into that room than with a linear system, and additionally this perfect combination. And then this was like a little revolution, let's say, and I continued. I just show some pictures from this, my furniture track. I continued, and then I didn't have to make competitions. Banks came to us and asked. So this was a Swiss bank in Hong Kong, and I designed this. They wanted a mixture of linear and this system. This is Merrill Lynch in Munich in Germany. I just go through to give you an impression. This is a bank in a building of Mario Botta in Basel. And you can see how easily you can create all constellations in a building compared to a linear system. The table itself, very complicated things with movable desk. Some of them were closed here with glass because at that time you had a lot of heat of the computers and so on. Just go through to give you some impressions. Here you can see the indirect light. So all ceilings in those banks then were clean ceilings in white, and the light went up to the ceiling and came back without reflections on the computers. This is for the German bank in London. 600 dealers in one room. And that is something where we had also to work acoustically and so on. And after that, to finish my furniture thing, we had flat screens, and I thought, when you put so much effort in those tables, there should be a nicely designed support for these screens. So I designed these screen holders with two tubes going through, and you could establish almost every position in that. One of my most interesting buildings and something where my heart blood is in is an old factory, and I show this in the sense of attitude. That was a competition which I won with a sketch which I'll show you. It's an old factory which produced torpedo in the outgoing 19th, beginning of century bicycles. And you see the old factory here, the main building was this one with a long arm, which is this one, and the whole factory was destroyed in war. And an American advertising company from Chicago with their Frankfurt branch moved from the city out to this suburb because they were not able to pay the high rents, and they bought this old factory. And in principle, they thought the architect comes and, like all architects, say, okay, take away this old stuff and build a new building. And I said, no, don't do it. And this was my sketch. I'll come back to sketching later. This morning we said already, architects have to do sketches every day. Very simple, this is German, Philippe, can read it. This means light, this means reduction. It's very simple. It's a 30 meter wide building, which you cannot normally use as an office building, on four floors. And I said, okay, basic idea, concept is reduce. Take off the inner circle, so you have 10 meters here, 10 meters here, and create an atrium, which I then did. And I reduced all this space to have a side entrance, put a conference room, which I will show you again. I put a big hole into the facade to make an entry with your car. And the good thing about this building is these factories, they have a structural system which is unbreakable. You have loads on the floors of 1,200 kilopond per square meter. When we build today, it's 200 to 300. So on a floor like this, you can almost do everything structural-wise. So I did it, yeah. And here in the plan, it's the hole in the building, and that's the whole story. And it's a big, in a longitudinal section, it's a big hall. And as the street in front is a very narrow street, I made a hole for an entry, and this is for the courtyard. Then the building begins, and people were very skeptical, and we had discussions and discussions because they knew what comes, that I built a factory for them. And they wanted Frankfurt, they wanted shiny, they wanted polished marble and things like that. And I was convincing them every day. So this is cutting out the middle, leaving all the steel construction and so on. For 400 offices, you need nowadays almost 200 parking spaces. So for a period, we had to hang up the house to build a garage underneath. Go a little bit quicker. I tried to leave the facades like they were. We had new windows, but I took all the proportions. So for the surrounding and the suburb, and for the people that live there, that there is not a big change. But on the inside, where you just saw the hole, I made a factory. This is pure steel, not colored, nothing. It's just gray steel. And people were really frightened in the beginning, but in the end, it turned out to be a beautiful space, and it still is. And to tell you the truth, and that is what I say, that sometimes you as an architect have to fight. And in the end, it was economically, this building cost a third of the price which we would have spent instead of building a new building. And this is a responsibility that you have as an architect in a sense of the whole. Yeah. You see here this conference room, which is in the dark side of the building. And it's only just a trick to push it into the middle to structure this room to this atrium in the beginning and to this cafe area. And then this trick allows you to sit in the inner building, but to have daylight. When you sit in here, you can see the sky here. You can see it. This is the view from this conference room through the roof. Then my passion, furniture. And I put a lot of of work into, you see, every detail personally designed in the sense of the material of the building in steel. This is the reception. And these are some knots in the construction under the roof. This is architecture is a good concept, basically, but in the end, it's working till the last detail. Yeah, I tell my students, when you build a good building, you should think of the choice of this. There are houses where you touch this 20 times a day, and it's very important that it feels good. And this is an example. And it was structured that you couldn't hang a car to this point, because at that time, this company made advertisement for Fiat in Italy, in Torino. Some gimmicks, those people are in the air 60% of their time, so I said that they don't feel homesick. I bought from Lufthansa some chairs to put in their relaxing rooms. Some colors, but the rest was white and gray, which still are my favorite colors. And here a little bit to the atmosphere to explain that the reuse of old buildings does not mean to make compromises. For me, and I think not only as an architect, this is spatially much more interesting than sitting in an office of 2.50 meters height with a window in front. Yeah, so I left all the construction, which was a little discussion with fire brigade, as you can imagine. I left it open, and spaces like this with view to the atrium, which is a quality in itself, to a third of the price. Here again, the facade, which has a double layer. You see those frames, which are in a second level with textile behind it. So we have a good acoustic in this hall. And this is the end, the final result. And shortly after they moved in, all those heavy discussions were forgotten, and people loved it. They took possession and they took hold of this building. And for me, something, yeah, to show here, to say, okay, fight for your ideals, do something for it. Yeah. Now, two projects where Philippe was very much interested in, and which dominated, let's say, 25 years of my life. I show you two prisons which I built. And the attitude behind those two projects is to tell you, as young generations of architects, that of course architects want to get famous, architects want to earn money, everything is fine, but architects often forget that they have a duty against or for society. There is a responsibility for society, and this is much more than any other project. Something you give for society. And the story behind this is long. I try to make it short. As a young architect, still at university, with a colleague, we made a competition for a government administration building. So you might ask, how do you come to a prison to build a prison? So I never wanted to build a prison. And this building, we started planning this administration building, and then the government stopped this building, and they said, okay, but we cannot pay you. But the next project, we think of you. And a half year later, they called us and they said, okay, we have a good project for you, a prison. And you know, my heart fell down to my shoes, and I said, oh God. And I had the same impression like you from bad American movies, you know, Alcatraz and things like this. So we went there and I said, okay, prison, prison, what does that mean? They said, oh, keep calm. There is a new project from the beginning, Green Party at that time in that county. And I had conferences with Mr. Fischer, who later was our, Joschka Fischer, our foreign minister. They said, no, no, it's not a normal prison. We want a prison with a special aspect on humanizing prison conditions. And I said, okay, is this a political thing for the next election, or do you mean that serious? And they said, no, 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 serious. they meant it serious in all parties, because it took almost 10 years to build this. It's a little town. They stuck to their promise to give money and so on. I'm sorry, it would lead too much to explain everything. On the other side, I signed the contract because there is security measures and things like this. But I will try to tell you in short terms what it's all about. Humanizing prison conditions means at first to have a look on what is the current situation. And then we went for 1 year without doing anything planning. We went to Finland, to Denmark. I spent 3 days, as I am acquainted to Holland, 3 days in a prison in Amsterdam to study the situation in northern countries, because they were said to be very progressive in this field, whereas the southern countries like Italy, also Spain, had very poor conditions in things. And from all this experience, we put together some new things to it and tried to make a prison which really serves the name human prison. So some of the aspects where we were fighting for: no video camera. All things that happen in this prison is personal contact. So there is no video cameras on the floors. The doors are special constructions. There is no opening in the door where you can put food in. We said we don't do it. We don't do that. Yeah. And of course you can imagine discussions not for a day or two, but for months, because we were breaking almost all the rules. But we are happy we did this to have this contact. Then we said, okay, this is a group of maximum 26 to 28 people. And these are the cells, which we never called cells. We said these are apartments. And in these doors, there are special constructions with two lockers. So there is the standard locker, and each prisoner has his own key, which is a revolution in prison design, because from that day on, those people said, this is not my prison cell, this is my apartment. And I still go there once or two times a year to talk to the directors and so on. And when I visit prisoners, they say, stop at the door and brush your shoes, this is my apartment. And the same prisoners, years before, there is vandalism to up to 80%, you know, they ruin their rooms and so on. This as a small example, and this locker costs 200 euros to bring in the door. And there is a mechanism that this big locker is always priority. So it's thinking, it's doing a little construction sketch, and it's opening a new world. Yeah, and I could tell you dozens of these examples. For example, these courtyards, which are, you can see this here in this L-shaped type. The whole system here with the escalator is constructed that the prisoners, instead of, which is legally said to be 1 hour at least in a courtyard, our prisoners could, without extra personal equipment, be in those courtyards 24 hours a day. It works. So an architect cannot necessarily enforce things, but by designing things, he can prevent things. So we made it open, and we told the director, if you use it, in the end, we cannot influence your behavior, but we give you the means to do this. And this was done there. Just for the basic idea, for us, it was in office, we were always talking not about the cells, a special form of housing. Because German law, you have to understand, says that on the first day that somebody is imprisoned, long before he gets to court, we start a program of re-socialization, which means being aware that whatever somebody did, one day he will be out of prison and we have to reintegrate him into society, if we want or not, but this is a fact. So we say, if we take our own law serious, we as architects have to start to be able for people that run a place like this to start this re-socialization. Means that the conditions in that prison are not like home. but similar to that, you know, to and we did this on many details, which is far too much to explain here. So what you can see is we tried to make a site plan which is something like a city. It's a house with apartments. It's a street, a long street connecting everything. It's the marketplace or piazza or whatever you want to call it. It's a visitor center. So it's space to work. It's a sports hall. Here we built a complex, a swimming hall, which was then in all newspapers in Germany. Architects built swimming halls in prisons, you know, which was so stupid because government decided that in 5 years later there should be a hospital for elderly prisoners. And as they cannot be in a fitness studio, it was a good idea to have them move in a swimming pool. Yes, so we built a swimming pool, but then government decided not to have this thing. But it is there today, and it's nice, and it's good. This is the building. We said limited to 3 floors, which is for me the limit for living, also in apartments, that you all, even in the 3rd floor, have contact to the ground. This is a prefabricated building, you will not believe it, but you know, we have in East Germany bad examples of prefab buildings, the platte they call it. And here you see, this is one cell, and the trick is very simple, not to make one small window, but I designed a big window and 2 small windows, which enabled the light to go along the ceiling in the back of this room. So it's very, very open room. And then you do the simple trick of the back-to-back situation, you mirror, and then you get a facade of a prefabricated building, which is nice, not as a facade. And this is what I'm saying, of the spatial quality of this small room, which is not even, it's 9.8 square meters behind. Which gives it quality. And then we make courtyards, and I can promise this is not my personal feeling of how things should be, but you must be able as an architect to go on a level of the people for which you build. Yeah. Mm-hmm. So it's not always what you feel should be the right solution. This is the big sports hall, our swimming pool. For years we were in newspapers, and in the news, on television, everything. These architects, these are the workshops. I go a bit quicker. This is administration and so on. And then in 93, that is another aspect, there was a massive explosion 14 days before the prison started. Everything was finished, and there was a group of the RAF, Bader-Meinhof gang, you might know. The communist, no? Never heard?
No.
No? This was a follow-up of the 68 years where I also took part. We students went to the streets and fight against bureaucracy, against old Nazis in government and so on. And there were some people that did this on a radical basis. Bader-Meinhof were the head of the group. They killed people, which was terrible, you know, took hostage and killed people. And a follow-up group later, this was in 93, the original people were imprisoned and some dead, made an explosion. The damage was 115 million Deutschmarks at that time, which is 75 million euros. And the prison cost 250 million, 125 million euros. So big, big project and a huge damage. This was a political thing. I could say much about it. What I want to say is that the same people destroyed our office 2 times. So as an architect, if you do things like this, and it was very strange, you know, because I was the same generation and we were fighting for the same things, and we take a lot of effort to build new prison, and this is the result. It was incredible. So what I want to say is, not always when you do things, like I said, you don't get famous, you cannot publish a project like this because it's forbidden. but you have to do is as a service on society, and sometimes you are even punished. I had police protection for almost 2 years. They were day and night around my house because they thought we were killed or something like this, which I thought was stupid. But this is an aspect, and which I want to tell you as the next generation, that it's not always the big podium and things, but it's necessary to do it. The thing was restored according to our plans, and it's in function today, and it works perfect. And you see one of the courtyards where people now, on a sunny day in the afternoon, 4 or 5 hours, lie in the grass between flowers and read a book. And this is worth while the work. And then I came, I thought, okay, yeah, going like this, that's it. And then I come to Cottbus, and in the county of Brandenburg, they said, okay, the first thing we have to do is build a new prison, because prison conditions in East Germany were terrible. It's like after the war, the Nazi time, we push aside a little the history of the communists in Germany, but we had prisons where people were killed, yeah, and not one, in several. And these were not prisoners, normal prisoners, these were political prisoners. And that's why I understand that the new democratic government very shortly wanted, and they said, you have to do it. And I said, no, sorry, but a project of this size, you have to make a competition, Philippe, yeah? And they said, no time for competitions, you do it. And as you work for the county of Brandenburg, we can order, give you the order to do so. Okay, then very shortly, I mean, the principle remained the same. You see these elf-shaped buildings around the courtyards, which is a principle, very good. You see the big space in the middle. So if you go from your apartment house, let's say, to the work or elsewhere, that was the visitors' building administration. And then government said, okay, this is too expensive. You have to do with people that are a little strange. So they forced me not to build it round, not like this. But at the quality of this, it doesn't change much. That was a little model. We talked to the students this morning. You can do that in an hour or two easily and get an impression of the site. This is the final project then. This is from above. And as I had the advantage that all the people in ministry were new after reunification, they had no idea. So I could serve myself in the size of the site. You can see there's a big distance between the houses and the wall, surrounding wall, which is very nice. There is a huge field of sports activities and gardening here. All things that I, you know, created beside all those strict orders. But you see the size is as big as the village, is the suburb of Cottbus. From above. Very similar with changes, but in principle it remains something, insofar it can be a little quicker. The energy supply, the workshops are industrial buildings like this, with some details which are in order. The houses, the courtyards, this is a little library and some education rooms, because in this prison there are 30 to 35% young prisoners. I built a little concert hall because I said, okay, you can have some rock concerts in there. There is also a chapel for priests on Sunday. A sports hall, simple. It's just a box, a concrete box, with a little glass and glass on top, a little sunshade. Sometimes architecture is not revolution. It's just thinking, and like Mies van der Rohe said, less is more. Yeah, take all the decoration away and it's good enough. This is the administration building with the visitor center. to finish this, I mean, if you do something, you keep it in mind as students, if you do something more than two times, you are a specialist for that as an architect. If you build a church two times, you are a specialist for building churches. So I had built two prisons, and then I was invited as one of five international offices, one American, two Canadians, and an English one, and me, to build for the United Arab Emirates and the Emirate of Abu Dhabi a prison in the middle of nowhere. Suwayhan is in the desert, and it's a crossing of two desert streets, and there's nothing. And I thought, in the beginning, I thought this is all very strange and very peculiar. And then comes the number, and I thought this is a mistake, for 5,000 people. And I thought they mean 500, and they put additionally a zero, because we in Europe have something between 600 and 800 is the maximum capacity which you have in both of these buildings you saw, projects. And then I called them, and they said, no, 5,000 is fine. And I said, this is much more than your local inhabitants here, because most of the inhabitants are Pakistanis and so on, as you know. Okay, I was a bit skeptical, but when I knew that they have up to 30 prisoners in one cell under terrible conditions, I thought, why not? If you do step number one, do step number two, and also in a political system like this, which is a dictature pure, do something for the people. And when I've shown the project, I tell you my conclusion, I would not do it again, but that's another story. So I started. How do you build a prison for 5,000 people? Because with my little L-shape theory, you don't get any further, because that's a line which is some 10 kilometers long. So I remember these paintings, which you all find in books about architectural typology. These are typologies from history, from back to the 19th century, the first prisons, mostly in England, but also in the United States, from all periods. To make it short, I remember this, that you have arms. And the simple idea is that an arm can be short and longer. So when I flew back, this is a menu from Emirates, when I flew back to Frankfurt, without knowing the program in detail, this was my sketch saying, okay, and knowing that the Arabs like symbols, I said, okay, this looks like a hand or like a star, and I put a star into the desert. Yeah, very enthusiastic about that. And then sketches and sketches, and then it developed a space which is a little more public, a courtyard, an inner courtyard, and then these arms where you can have different sorts of typologies of prisoners. To give you an idea, in this is said to be an hotel, live 2,000 people that work, employees that work for this prison. A gigantic project. And then the idea was born, you know, to have this hotel, let's call it that way, to have workshops here, spaces. There was a mosque which had to be planned, a green belt around it, and I think it was a good design, a good symbol also. And then what I said before in that factory building, it's a task of an architect to go into it and say, okay, how do you do that in the desert? I came back to my three floors maximum. And in that area, you have for months, you have temperatures between 40 and 50 degrees centigrade. So we have a lot of machinery and air conditioning, but as protection against the sun, I developed a prefabricated element which has a multifunction, protects from climbing prisoners to the roof. It's a sunshade, and at the same time at the night, it can be used as indirect light. And this element then shapes the buildings afterwards. Too much to go into this. This is the main entrance, the square with the mosque and the hotel. Here, these to build step by step these arms. You see the green belt around with the sports locations, and the big hotel complex here. And then they wrote us an email and said, oh, we forgot completely, we need a court building and we need a new police academy. And then we said, okay, let's make a joke. Then they gave us a territory of 7 by 2 kilometers. This is 2 and this is 7. And then we made a big alley. And we said, as we are already planning this size, let's mirror this thing. And for the future, where you take the prisoners, I don't know. But then you have 10,000 prisoners and all these buildings along that row. This then was the final project. It was never decided, and I shortly come to that point. And you can see the dimension of from here to here, 1 kilometer, which is unnatural size. This would have been, an architect always dreams to build a high-rise buildings. I will never build one, but I said, this is my high-rise building in the horizontal. This is the hotel, which is a roof, a concrete roof on piles for almost 600 meters, and the complex, there is 2 meters in between to the roof of the hotel, just for sun protection. This is the inner courtyard with a mosque. I think I have to hurry up a little. The mosque, the inner courtyard, the courts, and you see the building with this roof shaped. Yeah, this competition was never decided. Instead, weeks after, they sent an email and said, to judge your project, we need some more detailed information, which means those Arab states think they are very intelligent. And it happened quite a few times, also with friends. You send the details and they build it with local architects and they don't pay you a cent. And afterwards I said, and this is a discussion we cannot lead here, but in a university you should discuss these questions. Take Rem Koolhaas building, this building for Chinese people, for Chinese television, which the press is people in their free will. The question is, I don't want to judge, I mean, at the end it's a personal decision if you do that or not, but can a democratic architect do something like this just for the purpose of earning money or building buildings? A question which I want in future also to discuss with my students. Very quickly, some projects, the factory for which I built all these banking facilities, I just go through. A lot of my life I took care of old buildings, like you see on that factory. This was on River Main Philippi, you know, opposite of Städel. There was an old villa which was bombed and remained just this after the war. And in the 50s there was a terrible building inside, and the city decided or insisted that this has to stay there. So what I did is, I did the same thing. I built a house in the house, and from the ground floor plan, just took everything out of the house to have a lot of space and put toilet, staircase, lift, and a little reception on each floor in a class building that then, as a class, goes on top over the River Main. A difficult topic, I have to admit. We did a lot of competitions for banks in the new countries, like we called them in East Germany. This was a competition never built, and I show this to tell you that work of an architect often is not paid. You invest a lot of things, but still we have to go on. This was an old mill building. You see these green buildings existed, and the rest was destroyed in war. And there was a competition for urban qualification of this area. A beautiful landscape close to Berlin, in the city of Brandenburg. This is the River Havel. And what I did is just simply create spaces. My theory, what I said in the beginning, architects are creators of space. So I took the old buildings and put some new buildings to it to create open spaces. Here is housing, which in U form goes to the water and so on. a lot to say. This is a very similar project, as you can here see in the construction, to the one in Frankfurt. And here you see a little how this fragmented area in a beautiful situation gets shape and form. Housing was not so much my thing. This is a project for 80 apartments for doctors and nurses from the hotel, from the hospital in Cottbus, which was built also 10, 12 years ago. One of my nicest projects is one of my smallest. This is in Utrecht at a canal. It's a building which is 35 meters long and 5 meters wide. And there is only windows here, and some windows here. So how do you structure this room that was a foundation and a working space for 6 to 7 people? So simple what I said, where is the dark zone? This is this zone. So I put a big curved wall and put a little pantry, some chairs, a little toilet, and so on, just in. And by this curved zone, you know, make a narrow part here. So this part is the entry, reception, some working spaces. There is daylight enough from this side. There is daylight here at the boss's table and the conference and the secretary. And tiny little project, cost nothing to do it. And the attitude is here. Architects do things on every size, and they should also these small things do properly. My last project I will show you was with a very world famous architect, a joint venture with Juha Leviske. If you don't know him, Google and look at his projects. This is Juha Leviske, a Finnish architect, is the master of light. He built churches which are unbelievable. And this is an administration building. You see here from the 50s, administration building of the headquarters of Caparol, a company which produces colors. I think they're also in Spain. They operate worldwide. And the task was to build an auditorium and new office space. And what we did is simply on the same scale, build the auditorium here and then put the office building, but divide it, and by thus making, this is on a little hill pointing to the valley, and by thus very simply making a gesture of an opening arm, which you see here in a 3D. This is the model. To come to the end, sorry that I took a little longer, I want to point out also that might be very ancient thinking or very conservative, I don't care. I think that this, I call it future system or whatever, the modern, the future, is not possible without this. You see here the Amsterdam houses. These are sketches very quickly done, and this morning I told the students it's even not that your sketch has to be beautiful. Your sketch maybe never has to hang in a famous museum later. A sketch is that first of all you show yourself that you understood something and you bring it to paper. In the moment you can make a sketch of something you understood. That's a simple fact. And the second thing is you show it to your teacher. And how bad your sketch is, he can read it. You don't, what I said tomorrow, you can show that to a Japanese who doesn't speak English or anything, and he, all immediately, he understands what you are trying to say. So what I want to say is also, it's not common today because all students in first semester, in my courses, it's forbidden. They start with their computers, which is terrible. And some drawings, because, you know, funny, this was 10, 15 minutes on a rainy day when we were in Holland. Dutch often go to water. We rent a little yacht, and you couldn't get outside. And you just make a little sketch, which is not making a sketch, which is understanding for an architect What is in the front? What is in the back? What proportions do things have? And how does the light feel and reflect on things and so on? It sounds simple, but I'm pronouncing it, and I want to stress out that this is something which is the most important thing for getting a good architect. To come to the final end, and this is very a sum up of my very personal opinion of what architecture is, and that's why before there are misunderstandings, Adrian was so kind to translate into Spanish. Making architecture is passion and dedication, I think. Passion is something, like I said, I was not born as an architect, but in the end, to make architecture, you have to be with all of your heart into this, like in, I mean, all professions do that, that you have a certain, but we are architects 24 hours a day, yeah? We are so crazy, we get up in the night at 3 o'clock to make a sketch in order not to forget something, and so on. It's attitude and conviction, not creating style, means you have to be strong. If you have an opinion to certain things, also to fight for your ideas. It's that personal memory and life experience, I don't think, to explain this further. That also means travel and get experienced. And to come back to the very first beginning, you do what you are. There is no question. There is nothing new in this world, only the context. And by getting new context, you have to have the experience and to sort it new. But without that experience, to see things, Felipe this morning said to students, you know, this building and this building and this building, you have to see the buildings. Even at my age, where I think I have a very professional sight on ability to think in 3D dimensions. Even for me, when I see publications and I go there and see the building, it's a difference. It has nothing to do with professionalism. You have to do this. It's influence and cultural heritage. That is something very positive for our Erasmus exchange. Come to Germany, learn more about our culture, not saying that it's the culture, it's a different culture, and get to know that. It's teamwork and ability, very important. Before I forget, all these projects that you have seen, in the end I had to sign them because somebody has to be responsible, but it's teamwork. It's in end, it's not my project, it's a teamwork, and you should in university try to get to this point to be able to communicate with people on a very good way, because later on this will be as a single person you get nowhere. Finally, it's craftsmanship and professionalism, and the very end, and this is little hope, and despite the endless work, it should be fun. You should go to your work, now as students to university also, every day there arise new problems. You should go there and have fun with what you do, because we have one of the best professions in the world, I think. Huh? Mm-hmm. Felipe? Okay. Thank you very much. Let's come to part three, which is very important for me. Not in the sense of compliments and nice, but, you know, questions, please. Or contributions or whatever. Or corrections if you have different opinions to what I said. What have I learned? First, I learned, because up to that date I never had a project of this size. I mean, 250 million or 120 million euros is a lot of money for a single project. This is number one, to organize also a project like this. And as a normal architect, in brackets, I learned to organize a project. That's why at the moment I'm very much busy in the field of project management, in sense of costs, etc. That's what I learned. The idealistic thing, which I do not want to exaggerate, is a deep confidence, really seriously, when I talked about this contribution, to be able, because under normal conditions I would never have taken part in a competition for a prison. I would not have the idea. But nowadays, also this was a very serious and a very difficult time for me with this destroying my office. I mean, Adrian was 3 years old. And somebody tells you they want to kill you, and you get police protection and things like this. Is not funny. But in the end, the conviction, what I said, and you know, take it like I say. I don't want to be idealistic, but for me personally, it was giving something to society, which I still feel that all those people in that prison have a better life, and maybe, and I'm almost sure about this. Their step back into society will be much easier. And you know, as an architect, I cannot change the world, but step by step. And if there are many architects in their fields thinking in this direction, then this is something, and this is a kind of fulfillment. If that answers your question, it's more emotional thing. And to tell you the truth, I mean, then my colleague said, okay, you're in a short time you will be a millionaire. In the end, on projects like this, you have millions of euros get as a salary. But at a time in our office, we have 40 engineers. And you can calculate 40 engineers per month, highly paid, how much money went out of the office. So in the end, also, without exaggerating, this project was one of my worst paid projects in the end, on a large time frame scale of 10 years. But you know, this emotional or idealistic is good, and it's still with me. That's why I go there. In Cottbus, we have a senior university. I don't know if you have it. Professors, if it's freely, at the beginning of the year, they go to administration and say, I offer a course. This year we're seniors, 65 plus people from outside, which are no academics or so, can visit university courses. And I offered a course of prison, yeah? Wanted to give a course on prison because everybody has this distance. And I made a lecture, explained German law, construction, and things like that. And the final, after one semester, the final event was we visit a prison together. My group was 20 people, 20 elderly people. And when I said we visit the prison, all of a sudden I had a list of 150 people. So we had to divide 7 groups and we went to prison. And for the first time in their life, they've seen a prison from inside. They talk to prisoners. And this is something which I constantly do and visit the one in near Frankfurt and in Cottbus, not paid, nothing, just to get a feedback on the work. I go to congresses. They're sometimes in Berlin. Students, they have as diploma work prison, and then they call me as an expert in the jury or something. So it's the topic is with me, and I like it. The terrorists that destroyed the prison was also meant for terrorists, because you know this terrible story, this Baader-Meinhof gang, they were imprisoned in Stuttgart, in Stammheim. This is a name which is like Dachau or Auschwitz, where terrible things happened. And one day, three or four of them were found dead in their cells. And the whole scenery of the protesting students said government killed them. I mean, they committed suicide in this prison. So one of the tasks for Weiderstadt was also to make a prison which is human, but which has a highly, extremely high technical standard. We have no video inside, but we have a wall which is equipped with everything the market has without building big fences. But you can have electronical equipment today which makes impossible that somebody escapes from there. So this prison, still today, is able to host terrorists of the baddest kind and still is human. This is to make a square into a circle. Yeah. On the floors, each prisoner has his key for his door, but not for the courtyard. I mean, this has to be organized. For example, the daily process is in the morning at 7, very early, all doors are opened. And then we created in the back of this L-shaped arm, we created a kitchen, like in a student hostel. They have their own little fridge. They have a little, along this long half, they have a little shop where they earn money when they work little, but they can buy things. And a group of 4 or 6 people in the afternoon can cook in this kitchen. And I personally insisted and said, okay, no opening in the door to put food in. The door has to be opened. And I said, okay, breakfast and lunch and dinner, people can eat in their cell, in their room, in their apartment, whatsoever, but the food is not brought to them. They have, even if they are individualistic, they have to go to this common space to get their breakfast. They can eat there in the group, and if somebody is so much individual, he can go back. These are very simple things. Most of them cost nothing. It's just thinking, and it's against the resistance of bureaucracy, but that makes humanity. And if there is something in the night and somebody is, you don't have friendly people only in prisons, as you can imagine. And if somebody is very aggressive, and I said, okay, then 2 people have to go there. For the protection, because it's difficult if 1. But the door has to be opened. No limits. The door has to be opened. And there has to be a personal confrontation. And you, as an architect, can secure this, or you can hinder it. If you do all the things and you put all the machinery to the ceiling, and then it's an unpersonal and a cold world. Sounds everything a bit idealistic, but it's a pity. I mean, if we have some Erasmus students, we might go there and I'll show you. And this is what it's all about, that you insist and that you believe in what you do. Of course, you do mistakes as well. But in this case, I'm convinced. And in the end, and that was very funny, because you confronted with 4, 6, sometimes 8 highly educated security people. Whenever you do something, they say, it doesn't work. And I say, it doesn't work because you don't know any alternatives. It doesn't work. They start with it. No way it doesn't work. And this, for me, is something like, and I'm very arrogant about this, to have shown all those people that there are alternatives that work. Yeah. And once again, it sounds idealistic, but it's reality, and I'm so much convinced of the task was humanizing prison conditions, and we worked on it, and we succeeded. Can you imagine that when you are in prison, I was in prison also in the night, the biggest punishment for people is at 10 o'clock in the evening, somebody closes the door and you're not able to leave your room. The taking away of your free mobility. I can tell you, I could make from this prison a noble hotel with 5 stars, with perfect, with television all day long, with sauna, with pool and everything. Punishment is not being able to take free decisions. But what I say is not to make prisoners a good life. This discussion we had, of course, many times, because people said, oh, we pay all this and this is comfort. And I say, sorry, but if you don't want to have this, change your laws. I mean, the law says we reintegrate people. We start with re-socialization. The first day we crap people, and then you say, okay, give them a little bit bread and water, like in the Middle Ages. We are a civilized world. We are democracy, and we have to take ourselves serious and our laws as well. And I said, okay, I can do that for you as an architect, but before I do that, change your laws. And we built, or search another one, who builds a brutal prison. But what kind of solution is this? We have no alternative. We are not in America where they kill people. Yeah, they kill people and then there is no problem. But in our states, we don't kill people. So there comes a day, if it is after 5 years, 10 years, 15 years, or sometimes in some cases where people have mental illness, it's 20 years. But then we give every individual the chance to reintegrate into society and live and lead a normal life. So it's not a question of comfort. It's just making the break a little less bad. In seeing, in the day you go to prison, seeing already the end where you lead a normal life in society. Sounds also idealistic, but there is no alternative. No alternative. Or you kill the people. Then you have no problem. And this is, yeah, maybe it's too specific because I'm dealing with this all these years, but there is no alternative. And this is what we discuss these days with all the refugees. The biggest achievement in our societies is civilization. And sometimes it's difficult, but you know what we discuss, especially in Germany, because at the end of the year we will have some say numbers, 1.3 million of refugees in a country which is big with 80 million, but 1.3 million so shortly before winter is a big problem because we don't have housing for 1.3 million people. And this has to do with dignity and things. And in prison life, it's the same thing. The human dignity and how do we deal with it? It's never a question of comfort and nice life and, you know. And from personal experience, I can tell you, you can put comfort into a prison as much as you want. You won't heal this terrible pain on not being a free person.
So I want to thank you once again, Jörg, for your magnificent lecture. And we will see you tomorrow with a correction from first degree students. And we will see you in Cottbus. Next year, we'll have the workshop with you in your university.
Yeah, I will be here until Friday midday, so anytime I'll be here early in the morning. Anytime you have further questions or want to discuss, I'm here. And I hope this lecture, like I said in the beginning, is just a starting point of a fruitful and successful student exchange, because it's all about you, not so much about us.
It surely will. Thank you very much.
Yeah.